Middlebury Language School. I am your classmate this year, Abigail Washburn. I'm in third level Chinese, 三年级, 中文学校, woo-woo. And I just feel really lucky that one of my dearest friends, one of my musical heroes, is willing to be here today with me to share our collaboration with you. It's been a very meaningful and transformative collaboration for me musically and personally. And here she is, the woman in the cyber flesh. This is Wu Fei.
Hey, 大家好, 很高兴认识大家. My name is Wu Fei. Yeah. So Abby and I have been friends, really, really close friends for more than 10 years. Well, 15 probably.
15 now.
Yeah, 15 since, and then we recently just released a record, and we are really happy to share some of the music with you. And thank you for having me. And thank you, Abby, for having me to share this with your classmates and schoolmates.
I wanted to say that Faye and I both have immune-compromised family members, so we didn't feel comfortable getting together in person. We're both quarantining in our homes with our families, so we're doing this on Zoom instead, and on Zoom, it's virtually impossible to play music at the same time because of the lag, the delay in time. So we aren't going to be able to play a whole lot live, but we're going to show you our writing process, and we're going to share how we created a lot of these pieces, and then you are going to see a live video or some kind of video of a performance of us playing them at some other day and time that we're going to share with you. So we will share songs and stories as we go, and we are going to start with a song so that you can hear something right away. And this is a song that Faye and I, in our friendship, have paralleled in a lot of ways our leaving our own native cultures to be in the other person's culture. So I left America when I was 18 and started spending a significant amount of time in China learning about the culture and the people and the language. And Faye also, how old were you when you came to America?
20, somewhere between 20 and 21, 20, yeah.
So it's, and then we both had these intense experiences of becoming an adult in another culture in a lot of ways. And then we started having major relationships at the time, at the same time, and then dumping boyfriends and getting married at the same time, not to each other, to other people, and then having babies at the same time. So our lives have really paralleled, and our love of folk music has been a real connecting point for us. It's been at the center of our friendship. And so when Faye and I both had babies, we were talking to each other one afternoon on my porch about songs that put our babies to sleep, because mothers need to sleep, which means their babies need to sleep. So this is I started singing Faye a song. I'm gonna tune really quick. So I started singing this song to Faye that I was singing to my little boy Juno at the time when I was trying to put him to sleep. The water is wide, I can't cross over, and neither have I wings to fly. Give me a and we shall go, my child and I.
So that's a song song from the Scott-Irish tradition. It's called The Water Is Wine.
That's right. And it traveled here to America and became an American folk song.
And when Aggie was playing Water Is Wine on her porch, and it immediately reminded me, because it's water, and it reminded me this super famous folk song from China. It's also about water. It's called Wu Su Li, Boat Song. And because it's just like very wavy feeling when I was listening to Water Is Wine. So I thought, oh, well, water, I just immediately was drawn to the water song. And so here is we can do this from the intro. And because it's from the Hezhe people in northeast China, which actually is this tiny, tiny group of ethnic minority group in China that had less than 30,000 in total. However, this song is loved by about a billion people. So whoa, y'all really made something amazing. And so Wu Su Li is a river that runs through China and Russia. So the Hezhe people, also called the Nanai people, they live on the bank of Wu Su Li River. And they live on the boats, and they go fishing every day. They, even 50, 70 years ago, they're still wearing traditional clothes made out of fish skin. So they're really the boat people. And the beginning of the song is them going on fishing again, and then calling out, because the river is very wavy, very curvy, and then there's also mountains on both sides. So it creates this echo effect when the fishermen, and a fisherwoman, a mother, fishing, and then while also having her little baby on the other side of the boat, it's like rocking the wave. So that's a song. When we did it together. So we will do the beginning together, and then I'll go into the solo side.
We're trying to figure out how to get our children to go to sleep, our babies. And did it ever work for you, Faye?
I think so. Yeah, I think so. Some of the songs are loved by, they have reacted. Even now, when I start singing these tunes, they're like, "Mommy," and they're like, "Stop singing, yeah, like, go to sleep." So it's horrible. Not yet. It's not even yet.
So we want you to hear a version of the full thing. And we did it about a year and a half ago, I think it was, when we went up to Louisville, Kentucky to perform. And they had us on the morning show. I think it was at 7:30 or 8 in the morning. Remember that? We were warming up our voices. But it was a Great Day, Kentucky. So you're going to see us on Great Day, Kentucky right now singing the song. Gay. Cool. Nice job, Faye.
Yeah, that was good. So Abby and I have been friends for more than 13, 14 years. And when we met and we fell in love, I mean, she was already singing some of the Chinese folk songs that actually I grew up hearing since I had memory. So I just like connected right away with Abby. And it was just really impressed that I was, oh, someone can sing my folk songs that I know by heart. But at the time, and then when we started to collaborate, and I also, from my background, and I got to know Abby more, and there was, you know, like when we had collaborated, there was ups and downs, you know, but right now we feel like that's really solid, our solid friendship. Also, we realized that our different cultural and different music backgrounds have nurtured this project so profoundly. And that's why we feel like it's very special. I started learning music since I was very young. That's why when I met Abby, I was fascinated. It was like, because I started playing music when I was 5, not by my choice. My parents made me to, you know, study zhong and piano, and really, you know, in China, kids really don't have much choices. Your parents decided you are gonna do this route, and then from this dot to that dot, there's no distraction. That's how I was raised. And so never really had a lot of fun actually playing music, because I was, that was like my job as a child. And so I just did everything that I was expected to do. It was just very strict training, very Chinese, I would say. Like, I don't mind that stereotype actually at all, because it is true. And Yeah, my father was just one of the typical tiger dad. So just, you know, hours of practicing every day. When I came to America, that actually I felt quite liberated from, you know, making good friends, like many friends from Texas, even, you know, from Colorado when I met Abby, and later in New York, a bunch of really amazing jazz musicians. I just feel like, and now in Nashville, all the really amazing pickers and from bluegrass tradition and old time and, you know, square dance and everything. I just feel, wow, musicians, really, it's like about playing music to have fun. But to my first 20 years of my life, or even 25 years of my life, doing music professionally, you know, competing and this and that, you know, there's a lot of good things that came out of it. It's just really built me a lot of solid foundations. Having fun was had none to do with having fun in the music. So that's my background. And so some of the pieces, actually, when I had to learn the classical Chinese repertoire as a kid, I felt it was the most boring music ever. It's hard to play and then difficult to understand because they show ancient, possibly 1,000 years old, and I don't understand why as a, you know, like a 9-year-old. But now I feel like as a grown up and living through a lot of ups and downs in my life, and I really start to appreciate these ancient tunes that is really beautiful. Especially during the lockdown, there are a lot of new emotions have come out that made me revisit the ancient piece. So I will just play a short excerpt from, it's from a Guangdong music, Cantonese, from Chaozhou. It's actually one of the six ancient classical Wuzheng schools. There's six major schools. This one is one of them. So it's called Hanya Xi Shui. And then the bending is very different from the very south versus the very north. I'm from the north, I'm from Beijing, but trying to, you know, understand the culture from very far, far away have, yeah, made it a new connection to this piece.
You know, that connects to what I'm going to share with everybody that represents my musical background, which is very different. Like Faye said, I grew up loving to sing, and I tried to take piano for a while in fourth grade, and I was really good at listening and then repeating what I heard on the piano, but I didn't like reading. And so I quit pretty quickly when I realized nobody would let me not read and just copy them. All through school, nobody, you know, called me out as potentially, you know, good musician or anything. So I just kept on singing because I loved it. And then I started going to China when I was 18 after my freshman year of college. And I just fell madly in love. The long and short of it is I fell madly in love with Chinese culture and how ancient and how intense it felt to me to be in that culture being from America. And as a result, it inspired me to think about my own native culture and and where or if there was anything as ancient and rich as the things I was seeing and discovering in China. And it was after my senior year of college that I was exposed to some old time Appalachian music. And as soon as I heard the rolling banjo sound and this high lonesome vocal over it, I immediately felt transported, like I was hearing something ancient, like there were ancient tones in what I was hearing. And it reminded me of what I love so much about Chinese culture. And as I decided to buy a banjo and try to discover more about American culture through the banjo, I discovered so much about how ancient our immigrant culture actually is. This banjo comes from West Africa. The fiddling melodies that it often plays with are from Scotch and Irish traditions, go far back into Celtic culture. And a lot of our native culture, our native peoples in America, have influenced the sound of this music that grew up in Appalachia, which we call the Appalachian old time music. And I got really excited about the idea that I could maybe learn some of this music and take it back with me to China when I went back to do other things other than, I didn't think I was gonna be a musician at the time. But it did end up that there is a need for English and Chinese singing banjo troubadours. That's actually like a genre, so I'm just kidding. But it worked out in my favor that I was able to become a musician. And so the next time I went back to China, I took my banjo and started doing gigs in bars, and that was over 20 years ago. So this is a song that I'm gonna share with you where it's an example of my songwriting because it's I wrote a song out of a traditional mode and melody. And just basically added my own lyrics and extended periods of the song to be larger, longer, and added a chorus. And I'll just sing a little verse and chorus of it. So I'm gonna play you a little bit of Hop High My Lulu Gal, which is an old traditional song and from Appalachia. And then I'm going to show you how I took the mode and the melody and extended it in places and added a chorus and share with you a song, a part of a song that I wrote based on it. Where do you get them high top shoes and the dress you know you wear so fine? Got these shoes from a railroading man and the dress is from a driver in the mine. Oh, hop high, hop high, hop high, my little girl. Oh, hop high, hop high, hop high, my little girl. Now I'll share with you a little piece of something I wrote. I got a mother, I got a father, diamond lace and stark white collar. She looks good, he makes the dollars. I'm just free to do what I wanna. I gotta run. Run, 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 run to the city, I'll run, I gotta run, I gotta run. So thanks for listening.
Hey, I remember. Yeah, I remember that song. We played our version too.
Yeah.
That's from the city of the refuge.
Yeah, city of refuge. Exactly. Yeah.
So yeah, that's Abby's the last solo record. I was on a couple of tracks, maybe even three.
And then you're living in New York.
Finally, we have our duo album now.
So, Faye, I remember sitting back in this back room of mine, and one day, and you sharing with me, you know, a lot of our process, writing process is just telling each other stories of songs we love. And one of the songs that you shared with me, you stood up and you suddenly got so much energy. You were just alive, and you said, oh, I remember this one song. I've loved it forever, and this girl in my class sang it, And I just thought right away, oh my God, this is so, I can't say the word you said, but like really cool. This is so cool. And you shared it with me and I said, Faye, can we sing that together? So if you'd introduce to everybody this song.
Yeah. This is actually a Henan opera. It's called also called Yu opera, Yu Ju, or in Chinese, because each, especially in the middle part of China, the central part, each province has it's been there for so long. It used to be little kingdoms, you know, about 3,000 years ago. So they all had their name before Henan, because Henan is a south of Yellow River, basically what it means is so like contemporary. So, but before it was like 100, 200 years ago, 300 years ago, it was called Yu. So the opera has been around for that long. So it's called the Yu opera. The Henan is like after 1949. So, but Henan is just a geographic term of where that comes from, but it's really Yu Ju. And it's from it's about Hua Mulan, the Mulan. This is the real ancient writing that's about 1500 years ago. It's like a from the North Wei dynasty, and and then this story of Mulan after 1500 years and has been loved by so many people in China, and a lot of operas creators had actually throughout different dynasty had come up with their version of the opera, and so this one became one of the most beloved version of is from the Yu Henan opera. So it says, "Shui shuo nü zi bu ru nan," is basically is who says
women aren't as good as men.
Women aren't as good as men.
Who says that? Crazy
yeah.
People?
I know. Yeah. So it's like so Mulan pretending as a man in the troop, and then
And so the part we're gonna do is this. This piece where she's sitting with all of her warrior, you know, her warrior buddies, and they think she's a man, and they're talking about, women aren't any good. What are women worth anyway? And she stands up and says, excuse me, but I'll tell you a thing or two about women. Women are heroes. That's what she says.
Yeah, heroes and warriors. So this is, So Abby and I, we just wanted to sing this so much, and it's really beloved folk opera in China, also loved by a billion people. So it's really cool too.
And usually we would sing it together at the same time, but because of the time difference, it would sound even crazier than it's going to sound already. So we're going to go back and forth.
Yeah, but you should check out the version on our record because it's really rad. It's crazy. We have some like avant-garde style arranging ancient opera. like this. Okay.
柳大哥将花当个里根儿噔根儿噔啊，离开片吹说女子噔个里根儿噔根儿噔。
相亲相恋男子大丈到边关女子纺织噔个里根噔个噔在家园白天去种地是夜晚来访面不分昼夜辛勤把活干将士们才能有这吃火穿
能要不相信那秦王之身上看咱们的血火哇还有一火山千战万险可都是他们练的有许多女英雄是夜把功劳见为国下地是代代出英贤
It's a we want to sing it with our like sword and
it's a we're gonna do another song now that makes us feel powerful. But we're just going to share the story with you and then let you watch a video of it. It's a song that Faye shared with me. It's from the Qinghai region of China, the Tibetan Plateau. And why don't you say a word about the women up there? They're a little different. They aren't quite as demure,
not like the typical sort of obedience of a, like a Chinese woman that from, you know, historically kind of always obeying and then shy and then not expressing, you know, love, romance, because blah, blah, blah. The culture tells you not to. But women from the Northwest in China, they're very straightforward and very expressive about when they fell in love with a boy, they're gonna just tell you, and then you should love me back because I like, we should be together. And then she will, so this song is called the Song of Four Seasons, is about a girl singing using the flowers that blossom in the four different seasons to express her love, her affection to this lover. And folk songs from Qinghai area also are called hua. So hua yu shao nian basically is flower and the youth. So flower or flower and the young man. So flower symbolizes the women and the young men. Shao nian is always means young men. So it really, most folk songs from Qinghai are called hua yu shao nian. So that really shows the romance, how much romance that's in their folk culture, that actually had put a definition to a definition of their folk culture, that they express their love so much.
I like imagining a woman up on a horse and she's riding over to her guy's house and she's just like, get on the back of the horse, let's go.
Beautiful songs, yeah, like Northwestern China, Chinese folk songs are definitely my favorite. Oh, they're just really, really beautiful. There's like a little curvy ones, little, you know, and then this like big grassland style.
We took this song and I just added banjo. It's got already got such a like horse-like, a horse trot, or I guess a horse running. Gosh, horse people know more about this stuff than I do, but it's got a real rhythm, and it's a constant rhythm. So Faye and I decided that I could add my banjo to it and turn it into like an old time melody, and play along with her. And then we decided at one point we really wanted to be able to share some of the poetic meaning of what's going on in the song with people who don't speak Chinese. So we came up with a poetic translation and actually switched the time signature at that very moment into 3/4 time, which is like a waltz. So it has a very different feel at the moment that you hear the English, and then it will go back into the fast paced constant rhythm of the 4/4 time signature after that. So we hope you enjoy. Please check this out. This is a clip from Oz Arts here in Nashville when we did a big show with a bunch of students that we had been working with around all the metro public schools. So this is called Song of Four Seasons.
Thank you.
coming up here. This is a song that was written by a woman named Lily Mae Ledford. Lily Mae Ledford out of Kentucky. And she had a band called the Coon Creek Girls back in the 1930s. And the Coon Creek Girls were about a part of this really fun radio program back in the 30s called the Renfro Valley Barn Dance. And things were so hopping that they were invited to Shanghai, and they got to go perform the Renfro Valley Barn Dance in Shanghai. And after they got back, Lily Mae Ledford wrote this song for her band to sing. It's called Banjo Picking Girl originally, but Faye and I have taken the song over in our own way. And Faye has learned how to jam out on some solos, some bluegrass old time style solos. And
that's really fun. Because it never happens in traditional Chinese music.
And then we translated at the end, did a translation into Chinese of, you know, the meaning generally of the song. So we hope you enjoy, and Banjo Gujang Picking Girls.
Going around this world, baby mine.
Was when I was going to Mills College in Oakland, California, between 2002 and 2004. I was doing my master's degree in music there. My first private lesson with my professor at the time, Fred Frith, the first lesson, he wanted to hear my previous recording, basically the compositions I've written. And I played him, I prepared like big solid, you know, there's a CD, it was like a CD, and had like a bunch of compositions. And then he listened, and then after he listened, he said, I hear a lot of cracks, but I don't hear Faye. And I thought it was really shocking that I didn't really understand what that meant. And then after about 5 seconds, like of silence, I was like, oh, that's not good. and I was really puzzled and kind of very saddened. So he encouraged me to, he just said, you don't need to think about structure, harmony, or, you know, blah, 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 and orchestration. You have, it's in your blood now. You need to let go of these things and just let it flow out. You won't lose any of that, but you should let that go because you need your own voice. And that's really changed my life. After that, I decided to give it a try. Basically, you know, I was already 25 or something like that. You know, I've been playing music for 20 years, like knowing that was the way, and that was a composer supposed to do, and just to fulfill the professor's, you know, like structure, and you gotta sound like this, you gotta study this school and that school. And no one had told me that I needed to sound like myself. So, you know, and actually now you look back, it's like, isn't that supposed to be the first thing why I even go into music? That wasn't my case. So I had quite of a you know, mental struggle during that time. So I decided to give it a try because it's really hard because, you know, without a score, I was like, what am I supposed to play? I played zero. I don't know. Someone tell me what to do. and then I decided, because the college, Mills College, had this wonderful environment of students, musician students were encouraged to break out all sorts of old rules just to have your ideas realized, whatever it is, you know, can be ridiculous or silly or whatever. But the point is to really, you know, to explore the unknown of yourself, the unknown territories. So I started to do improvisation. So I would just play something. You know, I've been also locked in and at home. There's been a lot of different emotions going back and forth with the situation, and also America, my adopted country, and my home country, China, also have been in this crazy relationship that I just been a very heavy period. So I would, this piece, this next little thing will just, I'll share some of the emotions I've been processing, whatever it has.
I was really feeling your use of the Gujung on the other side of the bridges. You know, most people might not know how a Gujung sounds. And the fact that you were on the other side of the bridges is really unique. You know, most Gujung players, other than creating, you know, slide pitches.
Bending this.
With a bending the notes. Other than that, most people wouldn't have their hand over their playing. Is that correct?
That's correct. Yeah, it's rarely used. Maybe, you know, you do this, who knows, once every 40 years. That's that rare.
So that's been a part of your exploration, is thinking about ways you can use the instrument that you've been told not to do. And so what if I try to do that? What happens? And how does that make me feel? Does it express something that I need expressed? Yeah. Is that right?
Yes, that very much so. From the, you know, when I was learning improvisation, and then many new ways of it, which is such a beast. This instrument is so big and so many strings. Like, you only just play this little bit, and like, you know, you gotta, you know, just, you know, explore. So I started exploring, and now because that has become part of my language and my need to actually to have all these new sounds, that's there. And so it's and our, you know, human emotions are very complicated. It can't, and you know, when you just do, there's a lot of things in the middle. What if, like, sometimes we have that kind of mood, but if we can't just like do, it doesn't say something I want to say, like, you know, just a half in between, because actually our life is like a lot of times are somewhere in between. We're stuck, little feeling, little dim, and then if it's always so, that's now I feel like those are not just a new element to me anymore. It's just I know my emotion needs to go there, and that can satisfy my heart. That's like my heart goes there because I'm a little sad. That's my sad area.
Yeah, that's your sad spot. I know. I'm afraid I'm going to continue the sad streak here. Certainly, Chinese-American relations and what's going on with that right now is a sadness. It's a heartbreak lately. But also, just there's a lot of things right now that make life very different, and different can be hard, and income is hard, and there are a lot of things. This being at Chinese in school at Middlebury has been a real bright light, as has your friendship and our music that we make together. One of the things that I know is important to both of us is honoring our past teachers and honoring the people who have handed down the music to us, especially this folk music, and Fred Frith handing down to you the landscape of going different places with your music. So I'm going to honor a woman named Hazel Dickens. And Hazel Dickens passed away a few years ago. I was lucky enough to know her in my life. And this is a song I learned from her. She wrote it, but it's in the style of singing that's a cappella Appalachian Mountain style. And she's from West Virginia, and she was a real brave woman. She stood up to a real union activist, because a lot of the people in her community are coal miners, and they were being treated like animals, worse. And people were losing their lives, getting black lung and dying. And that's still happening today, by the way, but it was very intense in her community back then. So she stood up and sang out about it. And this is also a song that she's singing about, I believe about women and a wish she has for someone in her life who's being abused to seek freedom. And it's a beautiful song that I like a lot. And okay, so here is Hazel Dickens' Fly Away, Pretty Little Bird. I guess it's just called Pretty Bird. I'll get a note here. Fly away, little pretty bird. Fly, fly away. Fly away, little pretty bird. And pretty you always stay. I see in your eyes a promise. Your own tender love you bring. But fly away, little pretty bird. Close comes the spring. Glows on tender flame. Warms this meeting, and love's tender song should sing. But fly away, little pretty bird, and pretty you always stay. I cannot make you no promise. For let you said love is such a daily good thing. But fly away, little pretty bird. For he'd only clip your wing. Fly far beyond the dark mountain. To where you'll be free evermore. But fly away, little pretty bird. And pretty you always stay. So Faye and I are lucky enough to have also gotten to be in another collaboration that's quite different from what you're hearing so far this evening. And it's called The Woo Force, and it's with one other friend named Kai Welch, who's an indie pop rock musician and songwriter. And he came to China one time with me on tour, and we ended up hanging out in Faye's apartment in Beijing. And we just started getting loopy and silly and writing songs. And some of them became really serious, and some of them were just wild, and some of them were just totally sarcastic. And this one came out of a time that was close to Chinese New Year, when after Faye had moved to Nashville. And we were talking about the stories of people not being able to get home for Chinese New Year in China. And we were feeling sad about it. And there were some tears shed that day thinking about all the people that weren't able to get home that day for Chinese New Year. And so Faye and I and Kai started writing this song together. It's called Paper Lanterns. And Faye, can you talk a little bit about the Chinese that's spoken in this song?
Yeah, the Chinese spoken part, there's, besides the music part, there's a part that I, when Abby and Kai sing and play, I read a letter in Chinese that's supposedly, like, I pretend I was my mom when my mom was a teenager, and she couldn't, she was actually, when she was a young woman, she was sent away to the countryside during the Cultural Revolution. And so she was missing her big sister or her family, who were really 1,000 miles away. So just missing her, just like a personal letter to her sister telling her that I thought I could return this year, and I guess not. So I hope you all are good. So, and then Abby and I, we sing in Chinese while Kai sings in English. And it's really like, just she and I, we sing 回家, means going home. When Kai sings the kind of the reality and we sing what the heart wants. So that adds a lot of the contrast and the intensity to the song. So that's basically, and Paper Lantern really, in the Chinese culture as well, even though it's actually during Qingming, when people would visit the dead, that's like a traditional festival, not a festival, like holiday, but it's somehow, it symbolizes something that we also want to use the lantern, that like it's an origami paper, and then we fold it, and then lit the candle in the middle, and then we send it out to have this wish to connect to the people on the other side. So it has a lot of symbolism going into this song, like humongously, I would say, because like every detail had a cultural link that we added into making the song, and cultural backgrounds, and that relates from the ancient time, what people did, still why we do it now. And also relating to people from other countries, other cultures who are dealing with the same difficulties, yeah.
And this video was made by our band's friend, Joey Ellis, who is a paper artist and a lot more than that, video artist in Nepal.
It's really brilliantly done, yeah.
We hope you enjoy it.
Remember, pictures of the place.
So this is a song that Faye and Kai and I wrote together, the Woo Force, and it's a very different flavor from that song. And it's called Good Girl, and it's all in English, so I'll let you figure out what you think it means to you. Unusually, Faye plays so beautifully on this. I'm gonna miss her.
She was born in a countryside town. Didn't wanna let anybody down. Worked all day and night on the family farm. Papa said, fall's coming hard, gonna lose at the cold. So I'm giving you fare for the bus to the county line. Find the train there, take it to the heart of Shanghai. Cause you're a good girl, always been Papa's little good girl. You're a good girl, always been Papa's little good girl. Her head grew heavy on the window of the eastbound train. Feels rushed past, she's flying so fast, she's flying so fast. Train stops first, steps she's shaking in the city street. She's looking for the cousin of a cousin that she's supposed to meet. You said, I'm giving you fare for the bus across town. You find a restaurant there and work in the heart of Shanghai. Cause you're a good girl, always been Papa's little blue girl. You're a good girl, always been Papa's little blue girl. Good girl.
Thanks for listening. That's a cheery little number, right? but a lot of the themes and songs that Faye and I write together and collaborate on together, it's some combination of totally original with two traditional songs put together, or a traditional song from America that we combine with a traditional song from China, or that Faye adds something Chinese to, or a totally Chinese traditional tune that I add something to. there's all these different possibilities for the way we collaborate. And you've heard a lot of the different ways we collaborate. And if you haven't really got, if we haven't really hit home the fact that we really like to combine traditional songs from America and China, we're gonna share one more piece with you. And this is gonna be a video, and it's a video Faye and I made recently, but I'd love for her to talk a little bit about it. We were comparing cowboy songs and from the US and from China, and I'll let Faye take it from there.
This song in this video that I sing is called Avarguli. It's actually a folk song from the Uyghur people in the Xinjiang in Western China. And I've known the song since I was a young teenager. Because the Uyghur culture, their songs are so, I would say so not Han Chinese at all. But as a child, I never understood because there's so many ethnic groups in China. And I grew up hearing songs from their cultures on TV and radio since I was like, who knows, 3 or 4 years old. So songs from Mongolia, songs from the Uyghur people, songs from Hezhuang people. And I, at the time, I just thought, oh, good songs. And so this one is called Avarguli. It's a girl's name from the Uyghur people. And it's, their music has such a, their own unique flavor. They're just so beautiful, and rhythmically is always changes. Very rhythmic and very groove, lots of groove, like which, you know, in the Han Chinese music, we rarely have that, I have to say. And so just like their songs always stood out in my head. Like I just love every song I've heard from their culture. And this one is because I've been to Xinjiang and the Gobi Desert, because when Abby and I were talking about like a, you know, American Western sort of a vibe. And I've also seen a lot of Hollywood movies about, so I kind of like, oh, you know what? I get like Xinjiang, because I would ride a train from, you know, Beijing to Urumqi, the capital city of Xinjiang. That was like 44-hour train ride. And eight solid hours when you enter Xinjiang to Urumqi, it was entire desert, the Gobi Desert, for 8 solid hours. And on the way, you could see like the ancient Great Wall, like little dune or little watchtower that's been there for probably 2,000 years. And it was so like, so intriguing in a way that image, and when I closed my eyes, and then the sound of the Uyghur cowboys in a way that, because they're also, they ride horses and they sing all these love songs. And so somehow it just, the sound and then the visual just match in my head. And then I tried this song when, with the song that Abby was going to sing, and they just really magically, matched somehow about love, about also kind of in a sad way, but still trying to hold up hope to find the, you know, the bright destiny. So that was really, really, beautifully done. I have to say this is a really, really beautiful song. Yes.
I really like the juxtaposition of the two songs, because Avarguli is full of this want, this desire, this hope. You have that feeling, like you said, of the wide desert and galloping through this wide desert. And this, there's this amazing juxtaposition with a perspective on the American cowboy that we rarely hear, which is a song of warning from one cowboy to all those young men out there wanting to become cowboys, and saying, come all you roving cowboys, bound down this lowly land. And he wants to tell all those cowboys, this cowboy stuff is not that great. It's really rough out there. I don't know why I left everybody back home. It's just not going that well, sorry. And yet there's still this longing, this sort of hope that there could be a return home. So it's, I really love the juxtaposition of the two songs and how they share a kind of a feel that made it easy for Faye and I to weave them together. So this is called Avar Guli and Roving Cowboy.
Flowing tear grew dim from my blue eyes. I'll I love her till I die. I've tried the Straits of Ramblin', I know they're trying well. I've crossed the Rocky Mountain, where many a brave boy fell. I've seen the wild and distant land full of Indian armed and wild. I'll never forget my dear old home, nor mother's sweetest smile.
And it's time to we're gonna have to say goodbye to everyone, I guess.
Or I guess we're gonna open it up for questions.
Oh yeah, I really appreciate this opportunity to share our music, our stories, with you. And we're all watching this from our own home, from our own screen. That's one thing we can totally click with everyone who's watching. And so thank you, Marae, to recording it also from your own home and your own computer. It's that really weave all of us together, that and also the passion for learning about another culture, another language. So hopefully we all will build a better future for others. Actually, it's really for others. If everyone is good, then our community, our country, our state, and will be good. So that's what I would like to just to share this, and the downtime, but we can actually do some deep thinking.
Right. About this is an opportunity. This is an opportunity right now, right? To I love how you say it. It's an opportunity to be in one place. We don't have to be anywhere. We don't have to be anywhere. A lot of people do, but we don't. And we have this time to really think and consider and wonder at how we've gotten where we are as a culture, as a society, as human beings. And one of my wishes, one of my hopes that I carry with me every day is that we don't let the politics of our two countries get in the way of connecting as humans, as human beings, because there's a whole lot to love on in both America and China and every place around the world. I love folk music because, and Faye and I talk a lot about this, it's the music that comes from the heart of the people. And it's amazing how the messages of folk music are universal. And there is no division between us when it comes to the matters of heart. And so I just hope we all go forward with that. And I know the people that are here watching and care about what we do and want to be a part of this community are already thinking that way. And I'm so grateful for you and grateful to be sharing cyberspace and real connection with you.
Yeah.
So thanks for that. And we would like to open it up for questions if anyone has any like to know.
Okay.